Ladies and gentlemen, welcome. Oh my gosh, what is that expression on your face right now? You look at me like you are stunned and you don't know what, you don't know where you're at. You don't know what time of day it is. You look a little bit worn there. What's going on with you, Dimitri? Before we do the grand introduction to the show, I need to know, why do you look like you've just been shell-shocked? You got that thousand-yard stare, that, what do they call that, that World War One or whatever, that thousand-mile stare, whatever they call that. You know what I'm talking about? What is that, king size? Oh! Sponsored by Reese's. Not sponsored by Reese's. That looks, and you know what I have? You know what I have?
The whole thing.
I have freaking water. Hey, man, with the effects stuff that I have on right now, this water looks so cool. So cool. It messes with me. Look at this.
Four peanut butter cups. And they were scrumptious.
But we're not here to talk about peanut butter cups now, are we, sir? We're here. Oh, and you got Snickers. We're here to talk about Snickers. And we're here to talk about peanut butter cups.
Because, dude, nothing gets me juiced more than a Snickers and a cup of coffee.
Yeah, really? You eat Snickers in the morning? I can't do that. I can't do Snickers in the morning. Snickers in the morning is too much for me.
This is the evening, so this is how I stay awake.
You said, I assumed that what you were saying was Snickers in the morning because you said Snickers and coffee wakes you up. So,
for
the studio audience, we're actually doing a show. It's not about candy. Dimitri likes to wander off into useless, pointless topics. This is Full Auto. This is iState TV's Full Auto. iState.tv.
Did you change that again?
No.
I thought this was Viz something.
No, the other show that we do is called Viz Previs. This isn't Viz Previs. This is Full Auto.
Oh, you're sticking with this one for a week?
A week? I think I can make it
but
a week.
But the format's going to change, right? Did you change the format this week? Confused.
I may have. we have somewhat changed the format. It was we. You contributed. You signed the social contract without your consent. So yeah, you contributed to. We're changing the format slightly. It's not really a big change. We're going to be doing with Full Auto. Since we're doing Viz Previs now, it's going to be a real exception when our show is not about guns. So we're going to mostly focus on guns. And generally, what we're going to do is we're going to have like two or three news items, and then we're going to have like a larger item for the second half of the show. So that's the format that we're going to follow this time. Dimitri, are you down with following the format?
For today, sure.
Now, I'm
sure tomorrow will change.
That's true. I do have a technical issue. So eventually what you're going to see is we'll actually have you'll see the article that we're looking at and little pictures and stuff. And it's going to be cute. It's going to be wonderful. But for right now, you're just going to see Dimitri's ugly mug. And Dimitri doesn't understand warming the audience up and getting things started. He just wants to dive right in and just go right into the show. Dimitri, I understand that you have some news items for us this week. Go ahead. I'll wait. Go ahead.
Here's the first one.
Okay. Oh, that's fake news. That's fake news.
Would you like to see another one?
No, I would not. I'm gonna take this back over here.
I got my gangsta guy here, yo. What up, cuz? Break yourself. Cuz.
This is a ghost gun. This right here has ability with a 30 caliber clip to disperse with 30 bullets within half a second. 30 magazine clip in half a second.
We have federal regulations and state laws that prohibit hunting ducks with more than 3 rounds. And yet, it's legal to hunt humans.
Say hello to my little friend!
Australia just said, well, that's it. We're not seeing that again. And imposed very severe, tough gun laws. And they haven't had a mass shooting since.
You know, semi-automatic weapons are not just about gun control. This is about national security. You know that these weapons
can shoot down airplanes.
Break yourself! Break yourself! Break yourself!
The big difference between an assault rifle and a hunting rifle is, frankly, the scope that one puts on it, and scopes can be purchased online.
Okay, I want to see people disarmed. Permits, they actually
I want people disarmed in our major cities. How's that for a plan?
We cannot let a minority of people hold a viewpoint that terrorizes the majority of people.
Could have been done on spur of the moment with a hunting rifle, very easily, as long as it was a double shot weapon. They could easily do it with something that you could purchase at a grocery store.
Say hello to my little friend!
I think the Second Amendment is in the Constitution so that we could have muskets when the British people come over in 1800.
I know what you're thinking. Did he fire six shots or only five? You have to ask yourself one question. Do I feel lucky? Well, do you, punk?
Frick yourself! Cuz!
Cuz we have a family that watches us. There's like a family in Taiwan that watches us, and I don't want to offend them. Because I am a decent human being, so we're going to go to...
No, you're a troglodyte. Come on.
No, actually, you're right. It's a force of habit for me to say that I'm a human being. I am actually an OP-er, and you Homo sapiens sapiens, you species supremacists.
Oh, my God. We eradicated your asses. There's only 4%
almost,
of you left.
Almost, but we...
4%.
We survived. You guys call us Neanderthals, which...
I call you troglodyte.
You call... Well, that's same kind of idea there.
Because in Greek, it means hole digger.
By the way, I'm very interested. If you're watching this video, by the way, if you're watching video, the video is on Liberty Principle, no consent from the governed. So Liberty Principle, you go there, you see full auto. So you can see in the video, if you're listening, you're probably listening to IPMNation.com. I think we're on channel 2. I got to make sure I got that right. I'm pretty sure it's channel 2. But if you go to IPMNation.com, you'll find us.
Just
and
like a troglodyte.
If you're in video, you just can like see my transparent headphones. That's right. I have transparent headphones,
just,
and you're
that's
missing.
That's just witchcraft. That's why we wiped you off the face of the earth, because you're into that witchcraft stuff.
That voodoo that we do so well is what you're talking about. But we'll in Vis Previs we may talk about the whole the OP and how the OP will rise.
So Christ saved humanity, but there's 4% of you that's not. So what's up with that?
I don't talk about such things. That's a trivial pursuits is what you're splitting hairs. Okay.
Like how do I beat that 4% out of you?
You're splitting hairs. That 4% has become the 100% within me. You know, if Rachel,
well, 100% within you, right?
If Rachel Dolezal can become a black woman with zero black woman DNA in her,
don't judge.
I'm not. I'm saying if she
you
can be,
know.
Then
you
I can become much, OP with 4% OP in me.
You've made a false statement.
No.
You don't know how much black DNA has been deposited in her. You don't.
I do. I do. Objective fact. I have connections and I know things. So, and we can just move on.
I think you missed the subtlety of my statement.
I understand, and I'm passing over it because I'm a decent human being and we're doing a family show.
You said she has no black DNA in her.
Again, family show. So we're going to pretend that you're only talking about actual DNA within her. Well, never mind. Never mind. Never mind. Never mind. You know what? Cut. Cut. We're going to start this show over again. I would, except I'm
but
too
you
lazy.
You wanted to
so.
Warm up the audience.
I think the audience is warmed up now. Are you ready for our first story?
Yes. I've been ready for quite some time now.
Oh my gosh, he's such a complainer,
format.
Such a
the
whiner.
New format is so exciting.
You know what?
Me.
Next week, you are the technical producer of the show. You're going to
I'm
make this show happen.
Quit.
Yeah, I bet you do. And you still have a microphone that you have to hold. I keep telling you, you got to
like
get a microphone. Because you make noises, dude. Dude, you wriggle that microphone around. People hear it. I get complaints all the time. I don't get complaints. All the time about your wrangling with the microphone. Seriously.
That's texture.
And you won't have... No, it doesn't add texture.
I am so sorry I interrupted you. The first story was...
It turns our fine... It turns our Glock into a high point. That's what it does. So, Virginia Governor McCullough... This is... I'm reading from Free Beacon. Freebeacon.com. Freebeacon.com. Virginia Governor McCullough vetoes bill allowing those
America's largest
with
abortion business
protective
commits
orders.
Over 300,000 abortions.
Holy
per
moly!
Year, and they receive.
You heard that right. They passed a bill. They passed legislation in Virginia, the House Bill 1852, which would allow anyone in Virginia who has a protective order and is over 21 to carry a concealed firearm without a permit for up to 45 days after the order is issued. It would then give anyone with an active order an additional 45 days to carry concealed should they apply for a permanent concealed handgun permit, which could take up to 45 days to process. The person with the protective order would be required to show police the order or permit application and photo ID. And guess what? Guess what Terry did? Good old Terry McAuliffe, one of the Clinton buddies, one of the Clinton gang. Buddy vetoed it because, you know, the war on women. The war on women is real, and it's stuff like this that's
I find this to be sexist, exceptionally sexist. A man is dictating to women, yes, you can or no, you cannot protect yourself, your life. I mean, how much more sexist does it get? It's not even like, hey, we're going to pay you the same. Hey, you know, you just wait for a big, strong man to come and protect you in a uniform if your life's in danger. Outside of that, you are completely vulnerable. Is there anything more sexist than that?
Yeah, and listen to his statement here, and I'm going to read it the way it should be read.
In 2014, there were 112 family and intimate partner-related homicides in Virginia. 66 of those deaths were with a firearm. I will not allow this bill to become law when too many Virginia women have already taken victim to firearms violence at the hands of their intimate partner.
Now, you're talking about a person who, in the PFA, the obviously the person isn't living with them. And if you want to talk about gun violence against women, the answer is not to disarm women. That's probably not a good direction to go. Dimitri, what do you think of this? Yeah. Give us your keen insight.
Statement. I think it's absolute sexism. It's typical of the large city Democrats to keep people vulnerable, whether it's blacks in the inner city that are vulnerable and need protection from the state. Women need to be vulnerable and need to seek protection from the state. People with alternative lifestyles need to stay vulnerable and seek protection from the state. Now, why not just allow people to protect themselves from predators?
Well, because it's possible that they might not handle the gun responsibly and they could drop it or something bad could happen. So what you want to do is, under the off chance that something bad could happen through a freak accident, make sure that the person who's facing a real threat doesn't have access to a firearm. This, to me, is a quintessential of the nanny state that presumes to know what's best for you. And in the name of protecting everybody else, it is fundamentally willing to cut you off from your God-given right to self-defense.
Dude, they might sell it like that, but that's not how I see it. They want you disarmed, not because it's good for society in general.
Oh, right. I'm just giving their sales pitch. Yes, absolutely.
It's good for them, for the power elite. What power elite wants inner city black people to have guns and actually be able to defend themselves? I mean, Schumer and
not good for them.
Schumer and his ilk are mortified at the concept that poor people of any kind be able to defend themselves. Because you know the first thing that comes to their mind is like, well, I've been robbing them blind all these years. What happens if they wake up one day?
Yeah.
Got guns.
Well, what happens when they realize that the welfare program and all this stuff is not designed to help you? It's designed to keep you right where you're at. What happens when they finally realize that? It's not just blacks that are targeted with welfare programs. There's whites. There's many other groups that are.
I find gun control to be racist.
Totally. It's racist and sexist, and we've talked about both of those in our shows.
And it keeps the weak in society beholden and desperate and dependent upon the state, which is exactly where certain elements of the elitist want you to be.
Oh, yeah.
So a woman who's being chased down by an ex-lover, we don't want her to be able to protect herself because, if she shoots her ex-lover in self-defense and actually kills him, that's pro-gun news. We don't want that.
Well,
but if her ex-lover shoots her and kills her, hey, we got to get rid of guns because they're dangerous.
Now, by the way, that those 66 deaths, I don't know the statistics there or where they're getting them from, but I just wonder of those 66, which percentage of the 66 was someone that used a gun to defend themselves from someone? That it was a righteous kill, so to speak.
Yeah, well, you'll never know that.
Well, I'm sure that some pro-gun folks are working on figuring out that stuff because they have done stuff like that already. Are you ready to move on to the next story?
What I need to ask the good folks of Virginia, I travel through Virginia quite a bit, and I love your state. I really do. But what the hell are you people thinking voting these people in? These guys are the antithesis of everything I think of when I think of Virginia, the beautiful state of Virginia.
What's their alternative?
Vote these bums out.
Well, who are they going to vote in?
Well, that's a good argument.
Yeah. It's
Someone who's not so anti-gun that he would deny women in desperation the ability to defend herself.
Yeah, well, good luck finding those people that will. I mean, it can happen. It has happened. You vote a certain number of people that will actually do something with the gun laws. That
Rand Paul, you got
that daddy, you know, some kinder, gentler nanny staters who are willing to say, you know what, children, we're gonna make your playpen just a little bit bigger. You know what? That's what we need. We need people that are gonna make our playpens just a little bit bigger. We need to find the bigger playpen politicians.
Well, if you can get them to make it bigger, then the next group will make it bigger and bigger and bigger till you actually have freedom.
Okay. Okay. You go with that. I'm not going to hold my breath cuz I don't want to die. I like life. I'm going to go on to the next story though. You ready for the next story?
Sounds good to me.
And I was going to do I switched the order around a little bit on you. So, good luck with that.
Who cares? Oh, you changed the format?
No, no. I didn't change the format. I'm not. Well, no, yes, I have. No, I have not. I have not. They're the eye rolls again. If you're watching IPM Nation, by the way, if you're listening to us on IPM Nation, and at some point you want to listen to the video, you can find. We post the videos up on our YouTube channel, State of Wake. So it's youtube.com/C. Or /C, whatever, /C/ State of Wake. You can then watch the videos after you've listened to it on IPM Nation. This is from Law News. That's Law News, LAWNEWZ.com. Masked intruder killed by AR-15 wielding homeowner.
Uh-oh.
But now this actually wasn't the homeowner. It was actually the son of the homeowner. And three intruders broke into the wrong home on Monday, which is just this past Monday.
Actually, I'd like to make a correction.
Go ahead.
They broke into the right home.
Well, yeah, that's true. They broke into the right home. Have you want to have some compassion here, Dimitri?
No,
I'm setting you up because when you hear the full story,
and then I'll go.
All right.
Then I'll go up.
All right. So this is in Broken Arrow, Oklahoma. All three of the intruders ended up dead. The person was a 23-year-old who was armed with an AR-15. And according to the Washington Post, the victims are all teenagers, 16, 17, and 18 years old. Apparently, the one are either 18 or 19 years old. They're not sure on that one. So what the cops are saying is that these dudes, they broke through the back door and of the house. Obviously, they were all wearing ski masks and what appears to be a planned thing. It was this was no spontaneous home. This is a home invasion. And two of the intruders were reputedly armed, one carrying a knife and another a pair of brass knuckles. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but a knife and brass knuckles against I don't know if he had a 223 or a 556, but either cartridge is devastating against the knife and pure terror against brass knuckles. So upon making entry to the home, one of the residents fired a rifle, striking all three of the suspects. I don't know what that means. One shot, or I probably fired multiple times, I'm sure. Two of the suspects died inside the home, while one was able to run to the driveway before succumbing to his injuries. Now, I'm judging by this story that he did not shoot the person outside his home. He only shot the person inside the home. And then a few hours later, they arrested a woman named Elizabeth Rodriguez, who was the getaway driver. And actually, I will say, I'm assuming that these are all boys, but it actually doesn't say. The only person that they assume gender on. They assume gender on the female, and they assume gender on the older male. But they did not assume gender on the 16 and the 17-year-old. For all I know, it could have been two girls and a guy. I have no ideas later. Anyway, she's likely to be charged. He is now. She's going to be charged actually with first-degree murder, a felony murder statute that essentially makes all parties to the crime liable for a death if it occurs during a felony, and the guy is not charged with anything. So what a contrast there.
I had read that the neighborhood had been burglarized multiple times in the recent past. And so whether it was these kids who were burglarizing the other homes or someone else, I suspect the burglaries will stop immediately.
I would suspect that maybe they're thinking, it's not easy picking. But what a contrast to the first story. Now, in the first story, how would they count these gun deaths? You know what? Three people died. This is a mass murder shooting. That's what they'll do. They'll call this a mass murder shooting. Another mass murder shooting happened today when a 23-year-old young man didn't try to negotiate with the people who were there probably to kill him. But
they exchanged words, if I read it correctly.
Yes, they did. They exchanged words, didn't say what they said, so words were exchanged. Maybe he warned them. I have no idea. And they still came forward. I don't know. That's pure speculation. But again, what a contrast to the first story. The first story where...
Two things pop into my mind. As a human being, I think of these kids because they were kids. Old enough to hurt you kids, but kids nonetheless. Immature adults. And I think of their future and think to myself, you know, who knows if they would have ever, you know, straightened up and actually added to their community and to their, and to mankind in general. That's the first thing that I think of. And then the second thing I think of is, statistically speaking, that first idea is bunk, and that the reality is that if you are bold enough to march into someone's home wearing all black and masks, chances are you've done this before.
Oh yeah, you've rehearsed it. You're a pro. These were pros, probably. I'm not saying for sure, but it's more than likely that these were pros. This is not their first.
My guess is this started off as like garage surfing, where they found some really cool stuff, and it escalated from garage surfing, which I've been the victim of here in my home, to, hey man, the good stuff's in there. Let's do this, and they got away with it a few times, and they would probably continue to do this, and it would probably escalate, because if you're a burglar, the last thing you want on you is a weapon. Professional burglars do not walk into people's homes with weapons. It's the hack amateurs that show up with weapons. The minute you show up with a weapon, it shows that you have intent to hurt people.
Well, they showed up with brass knuckles and knives.
Yes. So it automatically shows that they came into that house with intent. That if they did find somebody,
they were going to do things.
Exactly. So if that's the case, I'm sorry to say they got what they deserved. They invaded someone's home. Their presence there was a complete and utter threat to the people who occupied the home. And what's done is done. And for those of you who are in Europe, you should be envious, because here in the United States, we have castle doctrine in many states.
I think your caveat has to be for those of you who live in Europe and certain parts of the United States, because certain parts of the United States are just as bad or worse. Yeah. I mean, Virginia is not a totally gun-friendly place. Maryland's even worse.
Or New York or Connecticut or New Jersey or
Maryland
California.
Or California. Right.
Right. But for those of us who are fortunate enough to live in states that have castle doctrine, that gentleman with his AR potentially has overted? Overted? Is that the word I'm looking
averted.
For?
Averted.
Averted. God knows how many more burglaries for other people. And
that sounded snooty. I didn't want to sound snooty. Oh, I apologize.
That's quite all right. And has possibly stopped in its tracks the hurting and murder of other innocent people. Because this would have only gone from bad to worse with these kids.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I was being a bit of a devil's advocate in the beginning. I have no sympathy for these folks, and clearly what it was that they at least seemed willing to do. And I can't get inside of their minds and know exactly, but I know for me, I have no doubt. You know, if you hold me up, I unless I have something really, really valuable in my car, even though I conceal carry, if you hold me up, and you want to jack my car, I am probably going to let you take the car. I'm probably thinking, I'm not going to kill you over my car. So I'll let you go. If you break into my home, I ain't even messing around with it, because then it's more than just my property. you've invaded my personal space. Homie, don't play. Well, it's interesting. This guy had an AR-15, which people like to call an assault rifle. Would it have been different if he had a 38 or a 9mm? I mean, 5.56223 at that close range, way more stopping power than most handguns.
Did he lose his hearing?
Well, that didn't talk. They didn't mention that. But you know, if this guy's smart, you know me, I actually, every member of my family, we sleep with ear protection headphones by our beds at all times. So
seems a little paranoid, but yeah, I get it.
No. You're thinking, seems a little paranoid, but at the same hand, you're also thinking, hey, that's a good idea. Come on. Yeah. You know you are. You know you
need
are.
To get the digital ones.
Well, yeah, I'll get those eventually, but they're way more expensive. And
a silencer.
Well, yeah. Yeah, that would be the best bet if you could get a silencer. That would be.
I did a test one time with a little 38. Actually, it was a 32 in a shooting range. I dropped my hearing protection inside of the booth that I was shooting in, and I squeezed one off. My ears were ringing for a week. I wanted to see how bad that little 32 indoors would be. It was not good. So I can only imagine what
I can't imagine
a Magnum or a 40 cal or a rifle,
a shotgun,
yeah,
all of
inside in a hallway where the walls are not going to absorb that sound.
No, it's coming at you. And I did an experiment once where I just used my headphones. I had these earplug, you know, you plug them into your ears, music headphones. And I used those one time I fired my 9mm. Now, but I was outside. So it's a little different. I was outside and those headphones actually provided ample protection for me. But I imagine inside, even for a 9mm, that they probably wouldn't have. That's why I have the ear protector thingies.
So the argument that an intermediate cartridge isn't enough most certainly is at close.
Even for me, I'm thinking that, I mean, I'm not grabbing my AR first unless I hear multiple voices. If I hear multiple voices, I may very well. But if I, you know, it's much more likely you hear one voice, but I'm not grabbing my AR first. I will grab my AR if there's, and this is much, much more unlikely, if there's a threat coming from outside a group of people, I would definitely grab my AR first. And I think, well, I call it a yard gun. So something to defend your most people, if you live in the suburbs, you know, you're not going to have these massive yards. So, you know, a yard gun. I think it's adequate for that. Anything beyond that, and yeah, I think then you're talking about the higher calibers that we talked about last week, the battle rifle 308 and above. But clearly, the AR did the job. I mean, if he had a 30-round mag, I imagine he'd just pop, 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 pop.
Yeah.
Which, again, if he didn't have ear protection on, that guy's deaf right now.
I have a lot of questions about this shooting that I don't even know where to start posing the questions. They're just, yeah. Did he have hearing protection? Did he have a silencer? Has he gone deaf? I mean, it's almost sad that I'm more concerned about the shooter than those who got shot.
I don't think that's sad at all. He wasn't invading somebody's property with a knife and brass knuckles. He wasn't doing that. I do want to note, when you look at how the news covers shootings, whether it's home defense or whatever, they're almost always woefully inadequate when it comes to giving you the details. I know, and it sounds, you know, when you're a gun guy or gal, when you read one of these stories, if whether it's a lot of shots in which there was no lethality, or in which there was just a few shots and a high lethality, you want to know. It's not a morbid thing. You want to know, okay, well, what gun was used? Because if that was the gun, then that doesn't seem effective. Or, whoa, that seems really effective. I might want to consider that. They don't cover those details.
It's not that they don't cover it. It's that they are woefully ignorant of the subject. So I think a lot of them are embarrassed to try to go into details. I watched a documentary recently about the Miami incident. It was a half-hour documentary that I hadn't seen before, and the reporter kept referring to the magazine as a clip, a 30-round clip.
Right.
And he kept referring to the 5.56 cartridge as a high-powered rifle cartridge.
Right.
It's not. It's an intermediate cartridge.
It's
an intermediate cartridge. It's a high-velocity cartridge, yeah, but it's not a high-power cartridge. And he kept saying this stuff, and I was like, wow, this really discredits the guy in my mind. And most people watching this
don't even know,
don't get that this isn't a high powered rifle.
I wouldn't know it. I wouldn't have known it 4 years ago.
Yep.
I would have been just, oh, okay, 5.56 is a high power cartridge and it's got clips.
And there were so many other issues that I had with how and what he was reporting that for me, it completely changed the story. What he was saying changed the story. Even though I knew what he was trying to say, And so it begs a question, is it intentional or is it just ignorance? And it's a combination of the two, I suspect.
Yeah, I suspect that it's, I think you might be right. I think it may be more ignorance than intentional. But if, I'll say this, if they didn't have the ignorance, it would probably quickly become intentional.
Yeah.
But right now, it's convenient that they have the ignorance. Well, we're going to take our break here.
Yay.
And when we come back on the other side, we'll be talking two stories. We have two stories left to cover. Oh, man. Oh, that's so... He knows... I'm actually pretty hungry right now, too. So this is... All I got is I'm sucking on water down here. And he's floating Snickers. By the way, yeah, for those that are listening... He's floating a Snickers bar by the screen because he knows that Daddy want. I want. All right.
Dude, who doesn't like Snickers?
Commies. Probably commies.
Good point.
Excellent
Commie
point.
Bitches.
Right, exactly. All right, so we'll see you on the other side. We have two stories left. And the first story is about... Well, it's gonna segue from this last story. We're talking about quote unquote assault rifles. This is not an assault rifle, and a ruling that was made recently about quote unquote assault rifles. And then we're going to leave and talk about the last story that we have queued up is about a new group that is beginning to embrace gun rights that hasn't embraced it so fully before. We'll see you on the other side.
The Gung-Ho Commandos, best equipped boys in the field. All the equipment you need for fun and excitement in the Gung-Ho Commando outfit by Marks. Just look at all the things you get. There's a battle map and direction-finding compass, a cap-shooting automatic with gun belt and holster, a helmet, a canteen, complete mess kit and poncho. You get a cat-firing Gung-Ho hand grenade. And look here, this flashing battery-powered machine gun with moving ammo belt shoots rapid-fire bullets. There's a real-looking walkie-talkie, too, and a field pack. You get non-com stripes, medals and battle ribbons, even dog tags. It's all for fun and excitement.
Gung-Ho!
Get the outfit with all the equipment you need. The Gung-Ho Commando Outfit.
Gung-Ho!
By Marks.
And ladies and gentlemen, we're back. And we discovered an issue with the first half of the show. Hopefully we have fixed it the second half of the show. I don't know if our gain was too high, but it's a little bit hissy in the first half of the show. When you move around like that, Dimitri, and you shuffle and you shake.
Sorry, did that upset you?
It did that on purpose.
Wait, I'm sorry.
I'll wait. If you just want this to become the microphone noise show, we can...
Can you hear me?
Oh, gosh. Oh.
Can you hear that?
I'm going to wait. Let me know when you're done. Are you ready?
A little congested.
No, don't. Don't. No, don't. Come on. Oh, gosh.
You know when you antagonize me, it only gets worse.
All right, we're going to do the next item here, which is Fourth Circuit issues devastating opinion regarding assault rifles. Have you heard about this, Dimitri, this lovely ruling here?
I have. I don't know what to make of it.
So this is – it actually happened about a month ago. We haven't talked about it, but we're a little bit late to the party, and – futurely, we may do a longer segment on this, but I just wanted to touch on it just to make sure we covered it. Because, like, yes, we know about the Fourth Circuit ruling. We understand. So today, well, I understand. Dimitri is another matter. So today, the Fourth Circuit, and I'm reading from blog.princelaw.com.
Is that a real news source or is that a fake news source?
No, this is like Prince Law Offices. This is This is lawyers trying to reflect that they know what the heck they're talking about. So today, the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals sitting en banc. I don't know what that means. What's that en banc mean? Issued a devastating opinion regarding quote-unquote assault rifles, which are already illegal. Well, they're not illegal. Assault rifles actually aren't illegal. You just have to pay a lot for them. New assault rifles are illegal. Old assault rifles aren't before, I think, 1986.
And you got to get 83. You can thank Ronald Reagan for
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You can thank Mr. Ronald Reagan, the conservative god. So in Colby versus Hogan, the Fourth Circuit covers Maryland, West Virginia, Virginia, North Carolina, and South Carolina. And two of the states on that list are horrible regarding gun rights, and that is Maryland and Virginia. Kolb challenged Maryland's Firearm Safety Act of 2013, blah, blah. Let's get to the meat of the matter here. At the district court level, the judge ruled that the FSA was constitutional. While analyzing the Second Amendment claims, the court expressed doubts that, quote unquote, assault weapons, there's no assault weapons in this case, and, quote unquote, large capacity magazines were protected by the Second Amendment. As a result, the court employed an intermediate scrutiny and analysis. I don't know. Do you know what an intermediate? Are you a lawyer? As the case trickled up the court system, the Fourth Circuit then issued an opinion from a divided three-judge panel, that means 2-1, which found that the banned assault weapons and large-capacity magazines, not assault weapons, are indeed protected by the Second Amendment and that the FSA substantially burdens the core Second Amendment rights. Okay, great. So the smaller court ruled in favor. Unfortunately, the court sitting en banc had a different idea. It was happy to affirm the district court's opinion, in a large part adopting the opinion's cogent reasoning as to why the FSA contravenes neither the Second Amendment nor the 14th. However, the court did make an explicit statement, and this is the key part here. We conclude, contrary to the now vacated decision of our prior panel, that the banned assault weapons, not assault weapons, and large capacity magazines are not protected by the Second Amendment. That is, we are convinced that the banned assault weapons, not assault weapons, and large capacity magazines are among those arms that are like M16 rifles. Like. So if it looks like an M16, an actual assault rifle, that's enough to make it an assault rifle. That makes total sense. Not really. Weapons that are most useful in military service, which the Helbert Court singled out as being beyond the Second Amendment's reach. Put simply, we have no power to extend Second Amendment protection to the weapons of war that the Heller decision explicitly excluded from such coverage. So they're actually citing Heller as...
Dude, this is very good for me because my Toyota that looks like a Ferrari, I should be able to sell that Toyota that looks like a Ferrari for the same kind of price that a Ferrari is going for. That's the logic there.
He doesn't even have a Toyota, folks. He's lying. He's fake news. He's fake newsing you right now.
Yeah.
That's the logic. But what they're saying here, that the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, that the Second Amendment was somehow, they wrote the Second Amendment just to make sure that people can hunt. That's it. To hunt, well, and for sport shooting,
the word
and
the
yeah.
the verbiage used in the Second Amendment to bear arms is a military
term. It's a military term, absolutely.
That
it's
means
a military term
to be armed with military weapons. That's the bottom line.
Yeah, I'm
whatever they rule on. I mean, obviously, we're people are making it through the legal system that are completely retarded, and we really need to rethink our...
Oh, I don't think they're retarded. I think they just have an agenda. It's you know, I have a saying, Dimitri. Do you know what that saying is? Do you know what saying I'm going to say right now? I say it all the time.
More guns, more better.
That's true. And our last story is kind of about that. there is no rule of law. There is only rule of power. We understand anybody with even just basic common sense, if they read the quote-unquote founding fathers, and if they read the language and they understand what bear arms means, there is no doubt what the Second Amendment was meant to provide. And it was to provide, I'll word it like this, it was to reassure the people who were going to be hit with this new Constitution, dude, it's okay. We're not going to disarm you. And so if you don't like us, you can still use arms against us. It's cool, man. We're not tyrants. We're not totally taking over. Never mind if they actually were trying to take. Never mind. I won't get down that road. But it was an appeasement of people who were fundamentally after the con, because remember the Bill of Rights happens after the Constitution is ratified. And after the Constitution is ratified, there are a lot of people out there who were not happy with the Constitution. Like, dude, this is scary stuff. And like, okay, let's try to put some stuff in there to appease these people so that they don't riot. Because at that point in time,
dude, they weren't going to riot.
Yeah, they're going to do more than riot. They're going to revolt. And at that point in time, the federal government and the state governments would not have had the means to stop people from revolting. These folks just fought the American Revolution, and when they left the battlefield, they took their guns with them, folks. This is a well-armed citizenry.
Well, they had muskets, man, and they were fighting the British. It's not the same. The ARs and stuff, they're not the same as muskets. Hey, jackass, they were the most advanced military firearms.
Yeah, they had what the military had.
Correct.
They had cannons. There was no restriction. They had freaking cannons, folks. Some of these guys took their freaking cannons home with them. So, they were armed. They were armed better than the military, absolutely. And I'm not saying that the Second Amendment is some sort of noble reflection of the people who put it in there as, you know, some noble liberty ideal. I think it was a recognition of the reality of power. Dude, I mean, we better put something in here to appease these jackwagons. Because if you know how the Constitution came into being, the Constitutional Convention, the Articles of Confederation really didn't produce a very powerful federal government. And all these states, a lot of these states, what they did is they jacked taxes up big time on these veterans that came home from the American Revolution. They did property taxes. They did all kinds of very nefarious things so that the political class could take their farmlands. Lots of stuff was going on. So there was lots of rebellions that were going on. And the state political classes, they wanted a powerful federal government to protect them from their own citizens. This is how the Constitution comes into being, folks. It was not born of a noble idea. It was born of a necessity to create a larger power that could protect the states from their own citizens.
Yeah. Back to full auto, please.
This is absolutely relevant.
Was that the Constitution show?
Well, this is the point is that these guys, they're going to find whatever language loophole that they can to scratch away at your quote unquote rights given to you by the Bill of Rights. It doesn't really matter. Having an argument, having a debate about what the Second Amendment really means, doesn't matter.
Who cares? Here's the bottom line. The Second Amendment does not protect me and keep me and allow me to keep my guns.
No.
My guns allow the Second Amendment to exist, and all the other ones to exist as well.
Right, and the more that people reflect that reality of power to the governing, the more the governing will be like, well, you know, we better slow our roll. And in this case, these guys, they're living in a freaking bubble if they think that this would actually fly. Because if this goes to the Supreme Court and the Supreme Court rules like this court did, I'm not sure what's going to happen next. I mean, I don't think there's going to be a civil war. I think there's going to be civil disobedience.
Dude, no one's coming for your guns.
They can't. It's totally impractical.
Dude, no cop, and I know many, with half a brain, and I would say most have more than half a brain, would walk up to someone's house and say, "We're here to take your guns." They know what the outcome of that's going to be. It's going to be, "No, you're not taking my guns." And it's only going to get bad for everybody at that point. And unless they send in the National Guard like they did with Katrina.
Right, in New Orleans, yeah.
Yeah.
That's a show we'll be doing someday.
Yeah. With lots and lots of research. Because I really want to dig into that and tear it apart. But unless they send the National Guard around, and they're going to send National Guard from California to Pennsylvania, and National Guard from New York to Kentucky, because they're not going to send Kentucky boys to go round up Kentucky guns, or
oh PA no, they won't be sending your local sheriff. They'll be sending a sheriff. If you live in Pennsylvania, you'll get a sheriff that came from Minnesota. Or right. National Guard that came from Minnesota. Either way.
Someone who doesn't have to live in that community.
Right.
They know the ramifications of having done what you did are going to be very bad.
Yes, very.
In the medium term and long term for you and your descendants. And that's not a threat. I just want you to understand.
No, that's reality.
I think human nature is such that if they could have confiscated guns already, they would have. But they know that there's going to be pushback even from within the National Guard, even from within – when people realize what's going on, hell, the sheriffs are not going to participate, not because they're afraid of their community, because they're sympathetic to the gun owners.
Right.
That's the problem. That's the big problem for the state. So this court can rule whatever it wants. Until they send people out to start confiscating guns, I don't give a rat's.
I don't either. But I'll say the interest. I'm seeing anecdotal evidence, and I've actually kind of personally seen this happen with me. You're seeing cops more and more, especially the ones that are outside of the mega cities. You see cops more and more whenever they're talking to someone about a gun issue. They're more and more expressing, "Oh no, I'm for the Second Amendment. I'm not trying to." They're going out of their way to make it clear. No. I respect the Second Amendment. I respect gun rights. You know, I had something. I'm not going to get into details of this now, but I had an incident recently where I had to interact with police and I had to discuss guns. And the guy talking to me went out of the way to assure me that he's a Second Amendment guy and he's no threat to me. And I think you're going to see that more and more from cops are like, "Dude, we got enough problems. Dude, we got enough problems. You ain't putting us there. You ain't putting us in America, Luja."
I've had conversations with police officers and most of them give the same answer that you do. But I did meet a young cop about 10 years ago who said to me that, "What do these people need all these big guns for? This is crazy." Well, recently we were having a conversation. He goes, "Dude, I understand why people want big guns. It ain't crazy." So even cops who come into the force with one attitude start to amend their attitudes. One officer said to me that he's always happy when he pulls over a car and they hand him a carry permit because he knows the occupant is not a felon.
Right, right.
So he knows automatically. That doesn't mean that this guy's not, you know, trouble, but he knows the guy's not a felon and that he's sharing with me that there's a gun in the car. I mean, I'm already, you know, ahead of the ball. I don't have to figure anything out. This guy's sharing with me a lot of information just by handing that to me. And I was like, "Oh, wow, that does make sense. I never saw it that way." So, yeah, police officers are very sympathetic to the Second Amendment, but this ruling doesn't mean squat to me.
It doesn't, and I seriously doubt that the Supreme Court will. I just I just seriously doubt that the Supreme Court would uphold this ruling. I could be wrong, but if it does uphold this ruling, I think we're going to see is a lot of states that are going to quickly pass laws to protect. And they're not doing it out of altruism. They're not like benevolent leaders that just love you and want you to be free. No, no, they don't want you ticked off at them. So they're going to go out and they're going to quickly pass legislation to guarantee that the state's rights are protected against federal intrusion. Because, I mean, that's what will happen next. You'll have that. That'll be the next argument. It's going to be about gun rights is a federal issue, and it should be decided at the federal level.
Well, that's what Reagan did, didn't he?
Well, he pretty much did. Yes. I mean, yeah, absolutely. And it was unchallenged. Well, fundamentally unchallenged.
I have problems with Reagan.
Oh, me too. Me, Reagan. If you listen to Reagan's speeches and he lived up to his speeches, wonderful, wonderful stuff. He spoke, brilliantly, eloquently about liberty, but wasn't consistent in actually living it out as the president of the United States. And maybe there's a show in there as well. Are you ready for the last story?
I am.
It segues into, and this is on Bearing Arms, where we're getting this, bearingarms.com. Are we heading towards a civil war? And it's got a picture here, and I hope I get my little technical glitch fixed so that eventually you'll see the picture. The picture is of a group of quote-unquote Antifa, anti-fascist, they call themselves, Antifa.
Are those the same guys who are running around beating up Trump supporters, like stomping on them and stuff?
Well, there's some give and take there, but it's not from the Trump supporters. Within the Trump supporters, there are actual neo-Nazis. Within the Trump, I'm not calling Trump supporters neo-Nazis at all. But within that group, neo-Nazis are attracted to this. And in some instances, it is the neo-Nazis that are sometimes instigating. Neo-Nazis and Antifa have been fighting each other for decades in this country. And even among the Antifa, there are extremist groups. And it's really these polarized, militarized extremist groups that are really doing the fighting. For the most part, it's not most of the Antifa. It's not most of the Trump supporters. It's this small group of people. And one such group of people, I don't know whether they're part of whether they're part of that more militarized group or not, but they have armed themselves, and they have a picture of themselves. It's a young woman in the center, and she's holding an AR. Interestingly enough, she has an AR-15, which is there to protect against, you know, it's a crowd situation, so it's close in fighting, and she's got a scope on it. I think that says all you need to know about her gun knowledge. And then you got a dude with an SKS, and you got another one with another AR. And
take a close look at that other AR.
Which one? I did hear a story that one of them is saying, you know, that's a airsoft gun.
There's a lot of them that are airsoft guns.
Are there?
I've been looking at them. Yeah, about a third of them are airsoft guns.
Yeah, but be that as it may, some of them are real. That SKS looks like it's probably real.
It is, but nothing like a bunch of lefty loonies to go into a potentially threatening situation with airsoft guns.
Not cool. Really, really not a smart move. And it says here, since you don't every day see groups of left-wingers toting semi-automatic rifles strolling down the sidewalk, I figured I would follow them and record this odd phenomenon via Facebook Live. Earlier, the spokeswoman told me that someone with the brown berets. Okay, berets.
They're wearing brown shirts.
They're brown berets, and they're Antifa. Come on, people.
Dude,
do your history.
Dude, they're wearing brown shirts.
Well,
these guys are brown shirts.
She's wearing a brown shirt. The two dudes are not. But
yeah, look at the whole crowd. 90% of them are wearing brown shirts.
There's a fair number of them with brown shirts, yes.
Yeah. And they're calling themselves the Brown Berets.
The Brown Berets. She also asked them.
They're not calling themselves the Nationalist Socialists, are they?
No. As I walked next to them, I'm sure, We would encounter obstacles like parked cars and so forth, and I mostly would go around the other side. Okay. But at one point, I walked next to a dude in a yellow headscarf whom I tried to talk to before, and I brushed against him unintentionally. I didn't think much of it, as the sidewalk is only so big, but he apparently took offense because in retaliation, he walked backwards into me, pushing me aside. This is the sort of thing that I would normally expect from the right-wing military types, but in reality, the group was little more than an ad hoc left-wing militia, so I shouldn't have been surprised. Like their right-wing counterparts, most of these guys didn't exactly reek, and these words, this language here, this is not my language, I'm reading from the article. These guys didn't exactly reek of competence or experience. Yeah, you can see that in the picture. And that should be of concern to us all, just like you pointed out, Dimitri. Not just that they are, you know, if they're taking airsoft guns into what would be a gunfight, but if these guys are not disciplined, if they don't know how to hold a gun in the right way. I mean, this woman, for instance, she is what some people would call a shooter position. She has her gun in a position that she could quickly fire on you. She would be considered an immediate threat. That is not a passive position. All three of these guys, they're holding their guns in very aggressive ways that somebody could reasonably assume this person is an immediate threat to me. That gun, they could swivel that thing around at no time. At the very least, the other group is going to have to hold their guns in that way. So let's continue with the article. This is the sort of, okay, this normally. Lemon notes in his article, the 1979 Greensboro Massacre, in which the KKK and American Nazi Party shot up a march of the Communist Workers' Party. I personally don't think it'll go down like that. Instead, we'll possibly see a bunch of left-wing clowns and a bunch of right-wing clowns square off and get into a shouting match, and then someone hiding in the back is going to crank off around. Yes, just as they did on April 19, 1775 on Lexington Green. That's going to trigger a panic, and then it's probably going to devolve into a free-for-all in which police officers try to keep the peace between the groups, and they'll be caught in the crossfire. I suspect we'll see dozens of people wounded by gunfire. At this time, I think it will be... I'm skipping over some parts here. At this time, I think it will likely be an isolated incident, not a modern shot heard around the world. I agree with that. I don't necessarily think... But on the point of the lefties arming themselves, I just want to say what Dimitri said earlier. Dimitri, what are you doing? You're trying to look at the story?
I'm looking at images of these kids.
Mo guns, mo better.
Yeah, these kids are... To me, it strikes me like these kids got beat up a lot in school. And they're really pushing hard to look tough. Every single one of them is scary to me in the respect that...
I'm not sure one of them's not going to shoot their own partner's head off by accident.
Yeah. I'd be surprised if these guns were loaded, to be honest with you.
If you look at how this girl is holding her AR, she has her hand. Okay, she's got good trigger discipline. But she's got her hand on the magazine. You don't want to put your hand on the freaking magazine holding your gun. There's all kinds of reasons not to do that. It might be a good thing because she can end up jamming her gun pretty easily, but... just certain things here that you look at this, you're like, these people don't know. They don't understand guns. It's like people who really, to me, now I do know that there are some leftist groups that are actually pretty disciplined when it comes to gun ownership. They're very responsible. They love guns. There are leftists who have always been Second Amendment supporters consistently. They exist. I mean, they're not unicorns. They might be like albino deer, but they're not unicorns. They exist. But for the most part, these lefties are going around out and they're grabbing guns, but they're not doing they don't love guns. They don't respect guns. And when you love guns and you respect guns, you know to treat them in a certain way. This is a freaking deadly weapon. As much as I love guns, I know I'm holding a deadly weapon, and God forbid if I ever did anything that would hurt someone around me or myself. And God forbid, like when I'm in a situation and I know that I have a gun, I'm extra careful to keep my tone really respectful. Not because I'm afraid of them, but because I don't want to put myself in a position where I have to shoot somebody just because really at the end of the day, it was some trivial matter. And these lefties, I doubt very much that that's how they're thinking. And on the right, I strongly suspect that the right has a whole lot more disciplined gun owners than the left does. But there are among the right, there's also young kids, just like on the left. There are also nerdy, whatever, young kids that are looking to prove they're tough, and they're going to go grab their guns and go on out there, and they don't love guns. They don't respect guns. They just want to say, you know, we're tough. We could do this. Oh, yeah? You don't think a leftist can hold a gun?
Yeah, the important thing for me isn't that these guys are walking up and down the street, you know, brandishing some real guns, some airsoft guns, and whatever else they want to brandish. The important thing to me is to go back to the title of the subject that we're talking about, which was...
I didn't necessarily want to have that. I mean, I'm okay with it. Are we heading to a civil war? That's the question.
And there are days when I look out and say, wow, the gap between the two parties is growing so vastly that it's not a gap anymore. It's a chasm. And some of the stuff is irreconcilable? Irreconcilable.
Oh, yeah. There's fundamental existential differences to how the world should be. You cannot compromise.
No, there are things that I personally am not interested in compromising. Absolutely not. There are things that they feel the same thing about. So how do you come to a compromise when you're not willing to compromise?
Yeah, the idea of government-controlled health care, that's a no-go zone for me. The idea of not having government health care is a no-go zone for them.
What I don't understand is this repeal and replace. Why, pardon my language, why the fuck do we need to replace this thing? Just repeal it and allow the insurance companies to operate for health care like they do for the automotive industry. I think the automotive industry is a perfect model. You can shop from 30 or 40 different companies in any given state for automotive insurance. And I don't see any automotive insurance companies going out of business. They're not.
Well, insurance is, in most states, it's mandatory.
For cars?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's another issue.
But to use the general structure without making it mandatory would work pretty well.
Well, the problem is, I'm not going to get into a healthcare discussion because that's totally off topic. And the reason I brought that up briefly was this is just an example of where that chasm exists, that great divide. The left absolutely will not accept healthcare that is not controlled by government. And more people on the other side, and there's a lot of people other than conservatives on that other side, more and more people on the other side are saying, nah, fundamentally, you want single payer, that's a no-go zone for me. That's going to be a line in the sand that you,
yeah, but
if you cross.
You have the other side that's sucking up to the left and saying, well, we're
not,
do
not talking about the political leaders. They're all of a piece. And I said earlier, you're talking about, you got to find a politician. Good luck finding a politician that is not part of that group, that class, that whether you're Republican or Democrat, you guys all go to the same parties. That's the problem. The two parties go to the same parties. See, yeah. That's the problem. So
are we heading towards a revolution? And what will the sides be, really? I mean, the Republican leadership
sides.
Is, what's that?
There's multiple sides, and there's the factions are growing. Like the I mean, it's not just conservative versus, I mean, it's not progressives versus conservatives. There's so many other factions out there, and they're getting larger and they're developing more and more of their own strong identity and more exactly what they want. I mean, we're more and more libertarians. And within the libertarians, you have factions.
It looks like the neocons are on board with the progressives and vice versa.
They're very closely aligned.
Yeah, they both want big government.
But within the progressives, the progressives have been coddling and enabling and using the far left, the actual socialists, Marxists. They've been using these fringe groups and funding these fringe groups. They're not Marxist necessarily, but they've been using Marxists. They've been using Maoists and these other really, really far left groups to do, you know, to do their thuggery. And those groups are kind of becoming powerful in and of their own. So even within the progressives, there are these factions that are getting more powerful, that are getting legitimacy, that are getting funding. So I don't think it's going to be a left-right civil war. And that makes me think that there's not going to be a revolution. There's not going to be a civil war. There's going to be a devolution, maybe, where the United States of America will become multiple sovereign entities. That's what I'm betting. It's going to break down, and you're going to see like right now you see a lot of intermixing. You know, if you go out to your neighborhood, it depends on where you're at. Some areas are more homogenous than others, but in the areas where you have more mixing, in the area where I live, there's a lot of mixing. It's a pretty it's not dominant progressive, not dominant conservative. It's a pretty thorough mix. You're going to see people leaving those areas, and whichever groups end up claiming those areas, you're going to see massive migrations going on as everybody flocks to their own.
Dude, as that devolution, as you call it, happens, you're going to see violence.
Oh, you're going to see violence. You're going to see bloodshed. You're going to see, you know, many battles.
That will be classified, I think, as revolution. Are we heading for a revolution?
A revolution or a civil war? I think more it'll be a civil war. It'll be a civil war. It'll be like Syria, probably not as bad as, well, it won't be like Syria in the scale that Syria is. You have a lot more safe zones here.
I mean,
but
look what happened when the Soviet Union broke up. There were lots of skirmishes and dictatorships and force being used throughout the Caucasus and the Balkans and different areas of Russia. That's kind of, if you're thinking that's where we're headed, that's a very dark place.
I'm not necessarily believing that's where we're headed, but that's a real chance that we're headed there. I think there's other things that are going on, especially that have to do with technology, that may pull us back from that brink. I'm not sure, though, either way, that the United States of America continues in its present form. But I don't know. I really, one day, actually, it would be great. I'd love to spend a week where I had nothing to do but research and really look at all of the historical, similar historical circumstances to where the United States is right now, and figure out, you know, where are we heading? Are we heading to civil war? Are we heading to a more central command? Or are we going to see the emergence of state sovereignty? The best chance that the United States of America has is if groups decide that to settle on state sovereignty, and the progressive states can do what the heck they want, and the conservative and whatever states that they can, they do what they want, and the federal will end up being much less of what it is now, and the progressives can do their progressive experiments. That's the best chance that this union has to hold together, because
that'll never happen.
I don't know whether it will or not, but
the powers that be are not going to. They're not going to go down that road willingly.
Well, there could be, if they see the if they see the writing on the wall and they see that this is the best deal for them, it's kind of like, you know, I go back to the Constitution, the Bill of Rights. That wasn't necessarily the best. The powers that be, there's many in that constitutional convention in Philadelphia. Many of these guys were arguing for a lot more federal power than they ended up getting, and they settled for it because at the end of the day, they came to realize if they asked for more, if they demanded more, that they wouldn't be able to govern. So that might be the reason why they might accept this path if they come to that realization. You know, this might be a diminished status of what we want, but it's better than ending up on a yardarm swinging in the breeze.
My thinking is that they're going to be the elements that are like, dude, we have all this power and we're going to give it up. No, I don't think so.
And on that note, we are pretty much out of time here.
Yeah.
So we're going to end this show next week. We'll do this similar format. We'll look for news items and then we'll end with a more, some meaty topic.
So we're going to keep the same format next week.
We're going to keep the same format.
You sure?
No.
Okay, good.
I don't want you to be sure about anything. I want you to be unsteady because it keeps you on your game, keeps you in fighting form. It's all about being in fighting form, you know, that's what it's all about. So do you have any last remarks to our studio audience before we shut this puppy down?
Kali nikta.
Kali nikta. And I want to thank everybody for watching us here on Full Auto and listening to us. Again, you can watch us on the Liberty Principle page on Facebook on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. And you can listen to us on IPMNation.com on Thursdays at 6 p.m. And if you're listening on IPM Nation and you want to watch the video, because, man, we made it so exciting for you to want to see the video, then you can go to our YouTube channel where we post these videos for now, which is youtube.com/C/State of Wake. And eventually we will have it on the iState channel, but not yet. And that's it. And we're out. Go ahead.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everybody.
Be sure to like, share, comment, and subscribe to Full Auto across our network. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/Full Auto Show. On Spreaker, you can find us at spreaker.com/show/Full Auto. We post our latest episodes on YouTube at youtube.com/C/State of Wake Show. And if you want to write to us, you can email us at show@fullautoshow.com. For all of the links and latest news on our show, go to our website at fullautoshow.com.